Thank you. Hello. Hello. Okay. Yeah, so well, thanks, Pedro, and thanks very much for the invitation. So, yes, in this talk, I intend to present some ongoing research on TLS and HTTPS. And the name of the project is dubbed Everest. So I first have a few slides describing broadly what you are trying to do, then you have a demo. Then we'll go into more details about cryptographic algorithms and crypto protocols. So needless to say, HTTPS and TLS are critical. So the actuality there is that, in fact, more and more people are consolidating around fewer protocols. So doing your own protocol is considered by IDEA. So everyone ends up using standardized protocols. And TLS being the easier to use, it's maybe running something like trillions of connections every few days. In fact, most of the internet traffic is now encrypted using TLS, and it will become mandatory with HTTP2. And moreover, there are lots of other things like VPNs, voice, emails protected by TLS. So it's quite a complex system. At the same time, from especially from a verification viewpoint, it has the big advantage of being relatively small. So there is some cryptography, some protocol, some PKI, and in the protocols, there are crypto protocols and application level protocols. But nonetheless, we can hope to implement it all in tens of thousands of lines of high-level programming languages, which makes it, we hope, a reasonable target for full verification, which will not be the case for, say, a browser or a full-fledged operating system. It's also quite, as is well known, quite broken, and in fact, it has been, we have seen a succession of attacks, discoveries, improvements, and fixes over the last 20 years. The issues range from most practical but boring ones, like buffer overruns or failure of memory safety, to implementation design issues, such as problems in state machines, so logical flaws in implementations, to a misunderstanding about how the different bits fit together, and it's most notably the case for the PKI. There are also some specific issues due to cryptography with weak primitives or primitives that used to be okay and now are broken, and plenty of side channels. So more fundamentally, one of the big issues of the ecosystem is that the security is quite often implicit, so there is not a clear well-agreed, precise notions of security for TLS or HTTPS. And maybe as a result of that, APIs tend to be low-level and quite dangerous. And even in some cases, we discovered some flaws in the standard. So for the triple uncheck attack, for example, if you implemented the standard, you are subject to the attack. So the practical situation is that we have mainstream implementations that get patched regularly. So if we look last year for OpenSSL, there were 33 CVEs resulting into patches, so it's a few amounts. So it's reasonably safe to say that OpenSSL has never been safe so far. There was always some open attacks in there. And well, we should be able to do better. So what we propose to do is to rebuild a stack, a HTTPS stack, one component at a time, with strong machine checks of safety and security for every component. So at the same time, we are, and that's maybe half of the project, which I'm not going to talk much about it today, but we are developing verification tools, programming language, and compilers to support that effort. And by co-developing the two, we are hoping to improve both to the point where we can verify something at this scale. Finally, and in contrast maybe to some of the work building reference implementations, we would like our components to be usable. So we are aiming for things that are verified, formally verified, but also reasonably engineering, not too demanding in terms of resources, and reasonably fast so that they constitute a reasonable alternative, not just something formally verified. So we have a composite team involving essentially four labs, so three labs at Microsoft Research and one in Paris at INRIA, with a mix of systems, security, cryptography, and programming and verification. So one question you may ask is, why are we still looking at that problem? In a sense, TLS is just a secure channel, so that has been well studied and solved maybe a decade ago, maybe a bit more. And so something to keep in mind in the talk, and that I will try to illustrate as we go, and is that there is a cryptographic viewpoint to the protocol, but there are also quite different and conflicting viewpoints. And the lack of communication and synchronization between those viewpoints has led to many persistent difficulties. So let's start with the cryptographic viewpoint first. So we have, and that's essential for the design, but we get papers, typically, that look at one aspect of the protocol at a time. And to get something readable, simple, and tractable, they tend to ignore all the other details that are not relevant for that particular property. And so we get something that is nice and simple and intelligible, where you can actually convince yourself by hand that the proofs are correct. But they do not compose. And if you try to put all the components together and get all the security properties, there will be lots of details that are going to get stuck in there. And in our experience in particular, we expected we would be able to reuse existing cryptographic results, paper results in our work. And in many cases, we could reuse the ideas and the methods and the proof techniques, but not quite the results, because we needed slightly stronger assumptions, or an extra oracle, or some cryptographic agility, or some joint assumptions in some places. So in many cases, what is pointed to as the reference for the design is not quite good enough to check the even the cryptographic protocol as standardized and used. At the other end, you have the RFCs, and RFCs are specifications, but they are it's English, so it's very informal. And moreover, they focus on the wire format, so the main point is interoperability, not quite security. And things are getting better, but still, security is considered, it's not specified. So you have a section that says security considerations, and that discuss things to be careful about, or to think about when you implement it, or when you use it, but it's very far from a precise definition of what you should verify as a security property. Then we have the viewpoint of the implementer, where the main issue is typically not cryptographic security, but more mundane issues like memory safety and integration, and how to handle graceful errors, and also how to have a system that can be that is operationally secure, that involves a lot of care about being able to upgrade and to maintain the system and to evolve it over time. And finally, we have the user of the protocol who tries to use those standards and implementations, but because security is loosely specified and because the APIs are quite low level, in many cases, they end up misusing or misconfiguring the system. So there were a very nice paper by Vitaly Shmetikov and his colleagues a couple of years ago showing that 80% of people using TLS libraries were getting for OpenSSL were getting the configuration wrong, so that any certificate would be considered as valid no matter what the subject was in that certificate. So it's very superficial, but it if invalidates 80% of the deployment, it's much more serious than cryptographic vulnerability would be. So as you may know, we have been working on TLS for a bit longer. So we started with MeTLS in 2013. And there, the goal was a bit different. So we really wanted to understand why the protocol was secure and to build a reference implementation, not something directly usable. So we tested interoperability, but certainly not performance. And it was only up to TLS 1.3, and there were quite a few limitations. So we were excluding the actual cryptographic primitives and construction, so we were really sticking to the letter of the RFC. Also, the proof was machine-supported, but not fully mechanized. So we had, for the main cryptographic argument, for the handshake and for the record layer, we had paper proofs, and in some cases, the synchronization between the two was quite delicate. And finally, it was good enough to test it, in particular use it to look for attacks systematically, and that was one of the ways we found most of the state machine attacks, but it was not good enough to be deployed, and in a sense, developing a verified implementation and using it only to find bugs elsewhere is a bit disappointing. So this time, we want to get the tools right so that we can actually deploy what we are trying to build and verify. So the way it works is we are consolidating our effort on a new programming toolchain based on a programming language that is oriented for verification, and that is named F-star. And so it's a high-level language. I'm going to give you a flavor of that language later on. And we use that language as the one language for coding everything. So we have the implementation code, including low-level code. You also have the specifications. We have security definitions. We have cryptographic games. We have cryptographic constructions. And we also have the proofs. And so everything is packaged together, can be verified together. And then from that, we can conduct verification. And once we are satisfied that everything that is specified has been checked, we can erase the proofs and the specifications and just extract lower level code. So we get to C++, but we will not be able to conduct the proof and the modular reasoning directly at the level of C++ and sort choice. So nonetheless, we realize that C++ is unavoidable if you want to integrate with the ecosystem. So we actually spent a lot of time generating high quality readable code because we expect people to be able to conduct independent reviews at that level, even if they don't understand the formalism we have. And at a lower level, we interop with the rest of the system. And so we have some testing. We have been running interoperability for a few years on TLS 1.3, for example. But in summary, and before we switch to the demo, what we build is a single model plus implementation with formal support. And we get two things out of it. One of them is that we can validate the design because we take an informal design and we formalize it as something very detailed, which is an executable spec in a sense. And at the same time, we get a concrete implementation where we can work on performance and get the security properties that we get on the design done to the implementation of the protocol. Okay, so I have a brief demo. I hope it works. I'm demoing two components of the system. So MeTLS, which is our implementation of the TLS protocol, plus all the cryptography, the cryptographic primitives that are used to run TLS as a cryptographic provider. And so for this demo, I'm showing an integration in Internet Explorer. So we redirected calls from Internet Explorer so that MeTLS will be used instead of the default cryptographic provider so that we can experiment with TLS 1.3 and 0RTT using AI as a user interface. And as a server, we picked Nginx, which is one of the fastest web servers. And similarly, we replaced its cryptographic component that usually is OpenSSL with our own component with verified TLS and verified crypto. And we also added support for tickets so that we can experiment early with tickets and resumptions for TLS 1.3. So, where is it? So here is a demo. So it's not okay. I'm not going to detail that too much, but it's Internet Explorer running with a debugger attached that we can monitor the code to MeTLS underneath. And I'm using that because otherwise it will just work as usual. It just display pages. So if you load this page with lots of pictures, it's going to open many connections and do the multiplexing on top of that. And except for the debug information, you wouldn't be able to tell we are using our implementation or another. It's just fast enough at this level. You can see at the top that, if you look at the window below, if you are lucky, we can see that we actually try to negotiate TLS 1.3. But in that case, we fail to negotiate 1.3 with our server, which is also implementing TLS 1.3. So that's our test server that has been around for experimenting with TLS 1.3 running NGX in the background. And here we end up with 1.2. And the reason we do is because my client is using the 20th draft of the standard, and the server is using the 21st draft of the standard. So I realized that this morning. So to show the actual 0RTT, I'm going to use the command line demo. So here I'm running OpenSSL as a client, and I open a TLS 1.3 connection to my Nginx server running MeTLS. And the first session establishes a ticket. And now I can Okay, if I can find the right command line, yes. So I can then use the ticket that is established to open a fast connection. And there we can see that early data was accepted. So the very first request that was sent in the first message on the network was processed as part of zero RTT, because both ends could reuse the information in the ticket to establish keys without any additional entries. Okay, so that was the demo. That's quite minimalistic. Yeah. So the next, what I want to show is what we do for verifying implementation of cryptographic algorithms. So that's about low-level programming and functional properties of algorithm. And as a starting point, I wanted to show some typical code that you can find in OpenSSL. So that's a code for implementing, I think it's SHA-2. And it's a mix of assembly and Perl, which is not quite what you would use for verification. And the reason is, of course, that people want to get the maximal speed out of it. So in OpenSSL, there is code specializations and different assembly for something like 50 different platforms. And so and it means you're using this kind of scripts, and it also means introducing bugs from time to time. So I'm going to show you what we do instead for one sample algorithm. So that's Poly1305, which is one of the fast modern one-time Mac that is used in TLS for authentication. So it's a multiplicative Mac. So it works by encoding your data into a polynomial, into the coefficient of a polynomial. Then you evaluate it at a random point, and you mask the result. And it's quite secure. This mathematical specification is very simple. It fits in a couple of lines, as you will see. The implementation is more complex because it plays lots of tricks to go fast. So it represents numbers using multiple limbs, and it tries to save on the number of reductions and Gary propagations that you do using different tricks. So it means that at the same time, we can get a specification in F-star, so that's the first bit of F-star that I'm going to show today, that fits in this screen, so it's literally a couple of lines. While we can also have an implementation that is optimized on that text, together with the proof, a few thousand lines of code, and provided you understand and you agree with the specification, you don't have to look at the code. The verification chain is going to check that this is what is implemented by this optimized code for the platform, or it's going to return to you an error at compile time. So let's look at the spec. So that's F-star syntax. So we define our prime. We define an element as a natural number that is smaller than the prime. Then we define addition and multiplications in that field. Then you have an encoding of word. And then you have a recursive function that just evaluates the polynomial recursively. And that's what we are going to use and mask in the protocol. So why bother? Well, Poly1305 is relatively new, so new implementations are being added to existing implementations. And just in last year, there were three bugs, including one vulnerability reported in OpenSSL, in the implementation of that particular feature. So one of them is a buffer overrun, which is boring but very dangerous. The others are just incorrect results due in particular to subtleties in the assembly code to do carry propagation. So instead we are in F-star, and so but we want to have full control over the code that we'll generate. So in fact, we designed a subset of F-star that is intuitively the intersection of F-star and C, so that we get to a program at a low level and link with assembly code if need be, but still benefit from the full verification framework. Of course, we build a compiler so that once we have written and verified something in F-star, we can securely compile that down to C. From C, we use existing compilers, which is a big risk, but that's the one you are willing to take for now. There is actually a certified compiler named Concert, built by INRIA, and that's what we use for our formalism. So we prove that we compile to the semantics of C as used by Concert. And if you want, you can use Concert instead of GCC or MSVC to compile your stack. But if you do that, you are going to miss some optimization. So there is a performance cost in using a fully verified compiler. So concretely, here is, it's not that readable, but I'm not going to read the lines, so don't worry too much. So that's one routine computing the last polynomial added to the poly 1305 computation. So that's F star with the specification and the implementation. And it compiles to this, which is, if you could read the details, just C code, but with a very clear correspondence in the operation. So in effect, we are mostly erasing all the specs and the proof elements to get back to C. In fact, you can see that there is the code that is just copied verbatim, except for inlining some of the constants. And then we have a memory safety specification that guarantees that all the pointers that are passed in and out are accessed as they should and that they are live when they are dereferent. We have a math spec that relates to what I have shown earlier and that says what is the specification of what you are doing in terms of unbounded precision mathematical integers. And then we have a proof that applies the lemmas to convince ourselves that what we do in the code matches the mathematical spec. So it is correct, but is it fast enough? Well, the good news is that after quite a lot of work optimizing both the compiler and the source code by my colleagues, we can match or even exceed the performance of the best unwritten implementation coded in C. So here you have the numbers given in cycles per byte. And as you can see, we are slightly better and even much better than OpenSSL for portable C implementations, notably for Curve 25519. We are not as fast as assembly yet, so if you are willing to use platform-specific instructions, then we can't compete by writing code from F star compiled to C. But for that, we have a domain-specific language that does portable assembly and that gives you even better performance at higher verification cost. So the tool is named Veil. It was presented last week at USENIX. And the principle is the same. So here is the six instructions in the OpenSSL implementation. So here we just use exactly the same instructions in Veil, although they can be manipulated and assembled using procedures. And that was the instruction where carry propagation was initially missing, one of the three bugs I mentioned earlier. So this code is essentially unchanged and will be generated exactly as what you would use in OpenSSL or any target implementation. But you do have a mathematical spec plus a memory safety specification telling you what the math is and also what registers are being affected by what you are doing. And there is also some explicit proof annotations to convince the prover that you are indeed complying with both the memory safety policy we claimed and the math specifications we gave at the beginning. So the design for that Veil language, so Veil stands for Verified Assembly Language for Everest, is quite interesting. So we embed the semantics of the platform in F star, so that it is platform specific but easily retargetable. And we treat the specifications and the description of the processor as part of the TCB, but on the other hand, the source code and the Veil tool that generates the code and the proof can be untrusted because the result of its work is going to be checked using F star verification. So, and performance is unsurprisingly very good, so we match, we can match any assembly that will compile on x64 provided we can prove it is correct. And here the numbers are slightly better, but I will not read too much into it. I think it's a slight difference in the calling conventions that we use. But essentially, we get the best performance for things like AES, where using specific hardware acceleration is critical, and where we will not be able to compete just writing C code. Okay, so that's conclude the part on the cryptographic algorithm themselves. The next step is to look at cryptographic protocols and security rather than just correctness and safety. And for that, a big part of our work has been focused on TLS 1.3, which is quite an exciting revision of the protocol. So I'm not going to say much about TLS 1.3 at all, it's the result of an intense and quite strenuous discussions involving cryptographers, engineers, and many users of TLS. It's more modern. It removed a lot of the bad cryptography that led to dubious assumptions for TLS 1.2. It has fewer round trips, and so it should yield significantly better performance as well as stronger security. So for us, it's exciting because new implementations are required for all, and so the fact that we are developing implementations from scratch is less of an inconvenience. And at the same time, it's very important for us to complete as much of the verification as we can before the draft turns into a standard, because it is still, or it was still, relatively easy to make changes or to improve the protocol, and it's going to get incredibly hard. So for triple uncheck attack, the time to patch the protocol with the mandatory extensions was 3 years, which is too long. So what the status is, so as I said, it was quite active and complicated process. So we are at the 21st draft, and we were at the final call, but we went back from final call to do a bit more testing before going back to final call. So in short, it's almost ready to be turned into an RFC, but not quite, and it took much longer than expected. Also, from our viewpoint, several proposals that we made were implemented in the standard, and we think they lead to stronger security. They certainly lead to stronger guarantees in all the models we have considered. And so they include findings from our work on TLS 1.2, and also more smaller scale designs against downgrade resilience and fine prints in the new standard. So, interestingly, we also introduced a new attack in one of the drafts by fixing another, but gladly we fixed it before. I think it for after 1 month it was fixed. So this happens, but we have tools. We would not trust ourselves with most of those changes otherwise. So where do we are in terms of implementation? So MITLS is coded in FSTAR today. It has been running and interoperating with several other implementations for 1 year. We implemented many variants of the standard, so we are at TLS at the draft 1.3. It's still partly verified, so we still have to complete and integrate our work on verifying the handshake, which is also coded in OCaml and not compiled to C yet. So what I'm going to focus on today is work that we did complete for the record layer, where we generate C code and we have completed verification for that part linking to the verified crypto that I presented earlier. Okay, so I have a few slides showing what we mean by actual cryptographic verification in FSTAR. And the goal of those slides is to convince you that what we are doing in FSTAR is not so far away from what cryptographers will do typically on, with pen and paper proofs using game-based, code-based reductions to convince themselves of the security of their system. So we don't have functionalities. Instead, we have actual implementation modules. So each box represents an FSTAR module, which implements some functionality with some well-defined interface. And so we use them for everything, so for the implementation itself, but also for modeling games and cryptographic assumptions. And we use the very precise type interface of FSTAR, including the mathematical specifications if need be, and also modeling of stateful effects to capture what these primitives are doing and also what security properties we expect. And so the idea is that to capture in the formalism at the level of the interface all the properties we are going to rely on cryptographically in our proof. So I have a very basic example to clarify this method, which is to look at message authentication codes, which is roughly the property that we want for the Poly 1305 algorithm that I've shown earlier. In the talk, at least for a single message. So if we look at the interface of a Mac library, it's not going to say much about security at all. So it's going to have a function for generating fresh keys, a function for making messages, and a function for verifying messages. And it may specify the length of the tag or the length of the key. But it's not enough to reason about security. So instead, we write an ideal interface that captures the essence of security notions that you are going to rely on, or if you are constructing something, trying to establish. And so for Mac, in these specifications, we are relying on a log. So we have a log which is ghost. It doesn't exist at runtime. But nonetheless, we can use that log to specify what ought to happen with a perfect implementation of a Mac. So when we generate a new key, we say that the log for that key is empty. When we make a message, we add to the log the message together with its tag. And when we verify the message, the result is exactly or has to conform with the result of the lookup in the ghost log that you are maintaining. And so if you think of it, it's very close to UFCMS security. In fact, you can show that it coincides with it. And it's great for verification, because once we have this log and we can reason about it, we can reason about the log at the other end of the communications, and that's sufficient to do conduct or protocol level proof. It's not so great from realism, because we know that tags can be guessed. So our tab system would reject any implementation that may fail because the tag can be guessed. And so so we have to do a bit more before we are able to use that nice specification to continue with the high-level proof of the protocol. So to do that, we also use FSTAR to program a game. And so we have a game that defines UFCMS security. So it's quite the classic definition, except that it's for Mac instead of signatures. And so in the game, we generate a key. We also have a log, so it's essentially the same log. And we have an oracle for encrypting messages, and the attacker gets the oracle and tries to produce a forgery. And then we check whether it is indeed a forgery by verifying that it works and also checking that it's not in the log. So that's just a naive transcription of the game that defines UFCMA. And now from that game, we can reduce a deviation from the ideal interface that you like to use to verification to an attack against that game. So that goes as follows. So we have a concrete protocol, it's an RPC. We have a Mac implementation that is assumed to be UFCMA, but only computationally. So we introduce an ideal setting that you are going to jump to in a single game step. We have a filter that is going to use a log to correct all the forgeries. And because we correct the forgeries, we have the nice unrealistic spec, so we can verify everything and conclude the proof of security for the full protocol by typing. However, we still have to go back to the real world, and so we can also check by typing that anything that composes with the radial Mac interface is actually a valid UFCMA adversary, hence that the real system is secure except with the same security loss as the one incurred in the game that defines UFCMA. So that's a very simple example, but that's the basis for most of the proof that we do in FSTAR. So we don't do any deep cryptography, but we can formulate and compose existing game-based notions of security for all the primitives used using TLS, for example. So for example, I'm going to get into more details about the record layer. So there we need more than authentication, we need authenticated encryption, and we can write a game that defines authenticated encryption as you would expect. And we can transcribe that into a game written in FSTAR and capture its security by typing, again, to go, once we have defined that game, move to a world where we can use step checking and automated verification to propagate the guarantees given by this game. So the constructions we are going to do is for the record layer, so it involves combining a Mac and some encryption. So here, I'm not going to give you the details for it, but I wanted to give you the details for something that you everyone will already know, which is Encrypt and Mac. And so in that case, we have two modules with that require some cryptographic idealization. So we first idealize the Mac, as I've shown before, using the UFCMA assumption. Once we have that, we can verify by typing that we comply with the in-CPA interface, because we are never going to decrypt a message that was not encrypted before. So decryption is by lookup, not by actual decryption. At which point, we match the interface to idealize the encryption, and then which we can idealize, and by combining the two, we can verify without any new security assumptions that the Encrypt and Mac constructions give the guarantees associated with authenticated encryption. And so that's the general structure of the proof. So we have a module that captures any cryptographic assumptions you are making, and then you have a systematic way of composing them using flags to control idealization. So technically, we are going to verify the code no matter what the flags are, because we don't want to verify separately each of the intermediate games in the proof. So the proof goes for all the games that are going to be spanned in the proof. And then to conclude the proof at the top level, we just need to switch the flags one at a time to conclude, so which is completely generic within that setting. So, okay, so let's go back to TLS. So the rigor layer for TLS is the same, except that there are lots of standardized complications. In particular, there are many keys, there are many algorithms, there are many constructions. There is also a fancier model for key compromise, where both algorithms and keys or intermediate secrets can get compromised. And then there are engineering details like fragmentation, padding, and state. So it's probably worth doing because although it's less, it may be more mundane than verifying the handshake. It's a place where there were historically lots of bugs in TLS. Moreover, it was at the explicit request of the IETF, which observed that there was no security argument for validating the new proposals in 1.3. And so being able to validate something that complies to the letter of 1.3 was perceived as valuable on its own. And indeed, we were inspired by existing papers, but we could not apply any existing papers directly to get the security of the standardized record layer. So how does it work? Well, the record layer does multiplexing, and it multiplexes between multiple keys and multiple sub-protocols. And so at the top, you have multiple sub-protocols. You are multiplexing their contents using whatever key is available at that time. And especially in 1.3, many more keys are introduced. So you have intermediate keys for the handshake, and you have also a mechanism for rekeying. So you have to live with this idea that you are going to have a stream of messages exchanged on a succession of instances of your authenticated encryption primitives. There is also a new format that makes the multiplexing above the encryption and decryption, meaning that the content type is hidden within the packet, and it adds a bit of privacy, and also pragmatically it enables the encrypted handshake to masquerade as an application data, which is important for early deployment. So in our implementation, we build the top-level interface using nested modules that implement a new feature at a time. So we have the sequences of multiple strings driven by the handshakes. We have the multiplexing of contents within each stream with padding and length hiding. Then you have stream encryptions with packet numbers. Then we have an authenticated encryption with additional data. And below, we have multiplexing on the choice of the PRF and the choice of the MAC algorithm. And that's the last thing I'm going to describe in detail in my presentation. Okay, so we are at this level where we want to verify and implement stream encryptions for TLS. So that's the main modules in our implementation for it. So that involves some symmetric crypto, as well as a few modules for the record layer. So I'm going to give you, as expected, the security definition, then outline the constructions, the new constructions for TLS, then obtain concrete security bounds, then discuss what you did in terms of verification and what you get in terms of performance. So for the definition, I don't have an Oracle-based definition. I have a nice picture instead, but it's equivalent. So here we assume the key is established, and we model ideal encryption by using this log that is so convenient to reason about using tools like fstar. So instead of encrypting, we sample ciphertext at random and we stuff it into the table. And for decrypting, we just look in the table if that corresponds to something that you encrypted before, and we return that instead. So we switch from red, which is the real one, to blue. That is the ideal one that lets us continue the proof, and we want to show what the security loss of doing that for the target constructions. So now we look at the standard, and luckily there is much less variety in the choice of AAD constructions than before. In fact, there is a CCM, but it's not used that much, and if you look at the others, you have a choice between AES-GCM and ChaCha 20 poly 1305. Which both have roughly the same use the same construction, the same proof structure. So in fact, our implementation and the proof is mostly shared between the three cipher suits we verify for TLS 1.3 and the two cipher suits we verify for TLS 1.2, which are slightly different in their what is explicit and what is kept implicit. So this is a simplified picture of how it works. It's not very surprising. So we have plain text, which is arbitrary size, so the last block may be truncated. We have PRF, and we use the first output, the first output of the PRF to generate a one-time key that we use to build this efficient multiplicative MAC. So at least part of the key has to be used only once for that message. And then we put the additional data in front. We put the XORed ciphertext next to it. We multiply all of that together, and we have two final blocks, one for the length of the plain text and additional data, and one for the authentication tag. So in terms of assumptions, we rely on one-time MAC assumption. So it's like a UFCMA, but for a single use. So we have a variant of our specification that deals with that case. And the good news is that we get very strong probabilistic security. There is no computational assumptions for that bit. For ciphers, there is a choice between AES and SHA-20, and for AES, there are multiple variants. And there, we just assume a PRF assumption, that it is a PRF. And in the case of AES, we incur the cost of switching from PRP to PRF. Then we write our implementation and we verify it. And so what we get is a proof of safety. So there is no buffer overrun or privilege escalation just by running our code, which is the least to expect. We prove functional correctness, which meaning that what we the bytes that we output are exactly those matching what is given in the high-level specification of the algorithm. Then we prove security by reductions to the PRF assumption I mentioned, with and we derive concrete bounds by adding the epsilons on paper corresponding to what happens in the code. So right now, F-star does not enable you to formally reason about concrete probabilities, so that the computation of the concrete bound is done on paper on a proof that is structured and verified using our tools. So interestingly, that involves quite a lot of different proof obligations. And so I'm not going to detail all of them, but I just want to mention a few. So as we go down in the stack to build the TLS. So at the top, as we have seen earlier in my presentation, most of the effort is about functional correctness for algorithms like AES or ChaCha, but there isn't much to do. It just shuffle a bit. There is a deeper proof relating to a simpler math specs for things like the multiplication in the Galois field for AES GCM and for the polynomial and the prime field poly 1305. So there is thousands of lines of implementation refinements of proofs to show that we match the algorithm. At the next level, most of the proof is about abstracting the details like the lengths and the that we don't want the proofs to depend on for the rest, and also about cryptographic agility. So TLS has cryptographic agility everywhere, so it's in that case, we really want to be able to prove that there is no bad interaction between different configurations that you may choose, and that, for example, as was the case for TLS 1.2, it's not possible to reuse the same key materials with different algorithms, which is at which point all bets are off in terms of security. But here, there is no such thing. It's actually worked quite nicely. Then we have the layer of security idealizations, where we have two idealization steps, one for one CMA and one for PRF. And on top of that, once we have the ideal log, we can reason about how the messages are assembled, fragmented, reordered, and cut from fragments to blocks. And so there is quite a bit to show in terms of injectivity, to show that what is authenticated is enough to authenticate the full stream. Then there are three loops to deal with the fragment loop, the block loop, and the block loop, and the authentication loop for the authenticator. From this point, the rest of the proof is much more about TLS engineering and has to do with multiplexing, padding, rekeying, and also the new feature like 0 RTT or 0.5 RTT. So, as I said, you obtain concrete bound, so that mirrors what was already documented in other papers, up to a few details that are specific to TLS 1.3. And because here we just have two idealized modules, we just have to sum the epsilons. There is one thing that is interesting here is that for AESGCM, because there is a 128 bit output for the block, we are there is arguably a chance of collisions as you, in case you use AES-GCM with a single key for a very long time. And so that was debated a lot on the IETF mailing list. In fact, we computed that since TLS provides its own rekeying mechanism, you can automatically rekey using what's already in the TLS standard to optimize and get a much nicer uncontroversial bound by just deciding to rekey every 2 to the 24 records in the record layer. And the rekeying is very lightweight. And it's probably important to rekey even faster than that, just to get a bit more forward secrecy for your connections. So as I hope is quite clear at that point, this is not just a proof of the design. We actually verify the actual implementation that I used to run the demo earlier in the talk, and we get reasonable performance. It's not as good as the performance from the unit test I've shown earlier, so we are still working on it. And so, for example, at the top, there is the time it takes to transmit 1 gigabyte of data, and you can see where we are right now. So we used to have OCaml as a backend instead of C, and OCaml is a high-level language, which is very bad at byte-level manipulations, and so you can see that we lose several order of magnitude just using a high-level language instead of C and optimized algorithms in C. So that's done. That was a very important step. So this compares our implementation integrated with the proof together with using OpenSSL. And you can see we are still a bit slower, but I expect most of the discrepancy to disappear once we integrate better the latest verified algorithm from tools like FAIL to our verified security stack. So for example, we are now at just 8 cycles per byte for an implementation using a portable implementation using ACLSTAR, which is a bit better than OpenSSL at least, until you start using X64 optimized much faster implementations. So there is also verification cost, so that proof wasn't easy in particular because it goes down to every detail to be standard compliant. But it's very modular and reusable, so we can build upon it, and it's very easy to add variants or variations of it. You can see that the proof consists of putting explicit specification annotations that get erased as we compile to C, and so, but because we also use metaprogramming to do inlining and to specialize the code in C, in fact, we erase the proof, but we inline and develop and express what you do in a lower level language. So the size of the code before and after compilations are not that different. Oops. Sorry about that. So in terms of time, so that's not the manual verification time. It took us a few months to get there and to get everything in place. But once everything is in place, this is the time it takes to verify as part of continuous integration. So we, every night we check that the differences introduced in the tool don't break the proofs that you already have. And at that point, it was a bit below 2 hours. Now it's more like 1 hour, but it varies on a daily basis. And so we are putting a lot of engineering effort to maintain our proof and to make sure we don't break things as we improve and add features, both to the protocol and to the language, but that's quite a significant engineering effort to get there and then to maintain it on an ongoing basis. At the same time, provided we get that ongoing, we can make a change, and 2 hours later, you have a full verification again, and in fact, most of the proof can be factored out because each module is verified completely independently, so it's not that bad from that viewpoint. All right, so time to conclude. So so in this talk, I presented what you are trying to do with HTTPS. We think it's, okay, we know it's quite complex and critical, but we also think that it's small enough to be in range of cryptographic verification at the level of details that gets into the standard. I did not mention much related work or colleagues as part of this talk, but as should be obvious by now, this relies on a very deep collaboration between cryptographers, system researchers, programming language researchers, and verification specialists, and that's quite a lot of fun. We also have new tools. I said very little about the tools themselves, but we have interactive tutorials, we have papers, there are lots of details out there if you want to check them out. I hope I have convinced you that we have a method to get safe functional correctness and cryptographic security for useful standard compliant system code. So here are some pointers. So the code and the papers, everything is available online. In particular, if you go to Starlang, we'll have lots of tutorials, including some cryptographic tutorials, explaining what it means to use the tool and giving you a way to start with the tools if you are curious. Okay, well, thanks.